Welcome to Inside the Hive TV, the show that takes you
where you wait. You said I could do this one.
I have a special guest today.
My intro.
Okay.
Everyone, Dr. Bugs here, your friendly neighborhood entomologist, and I am hijacking from the Hive TV. I am the special, well, no, actually,
very special.
He's the special guest.
Oh, okay. Okay. So just a great opportunity I got here to talk with my old friend that's just published a fantastic article in PNAS and getting a lot of attention.
Thank you very much.
Important work. I think the whole world can see that now. And I think I'm gonna let you talk because everybody know what the paper is about. Fat bodies are the main source of nutrient of Varroa destructor. But what people might not get it too much is, what's next?
What is next?
What is
That's a great question.
Yes.
So we have that. So what is next? That is a great question. And there's been a lot of talk about fat bodies and Varroa, and sometimes we can have too much of a singular focus on one, on the present and not keep in mind that the future is right around the corner. There's this parasite that I've been thinking about. I went to Thailand last year and saw this crazy parasite that was just destroying colonies. It's called the tropolelapse mite. And I'm thinking—
Just a second. If you don't know what tropolelapse is, I did a video a long time ago. If you don't know what tropolelapse is, please click the link right here so you know what the problem is. If you think Varroa is a problem, that's the devil.
They're wackadoodle. Crazy mites. And the reason why I feel like we really need to focus in on them right now is because the same issues that led to us thinking that these things, the Varroa mites, were feeding on the bees' blood, they're the same things that are happening right now that could leave us with some pretty sizable misconceptions about the tropolelapse mite.
All right, so what's next? Let me get a better frame here
with you,
the PNAS here. Here we go. Look at that.
Check it out.
Yes. Check this out.
It's so shiny.
Oh, look at that. First, it's the cover.
Yeah, right?
It's the cover.
So,
you know how hard that is?
Yeah.
You know how many scientists can get this opportunity in life?
Well, I do have to say that the United States Department of Agriculture has a lab called the Electron Confocal Microscopy Unit, and they really breathed life into a lot of this work because I can talk until I'm blue in the face about tiny little mites, but it's difficult for people to see them. They were able to take a lot of the samples that I was giving to them and put them in the electron microscope and produce stuff that, I mean, now everyone can see what I've been talking about. The Varroa mite under the plates of the bee, how it's getting through this membrane to all of this fat body tissue. That, I think, is something that really helped people conceptualize something that I've been talking about for a couple of years.
All right, so what's next, Sam? What are you doing? How are we gonna save the world of bees?
That's a lot of pressure. That's a lot of pressure. I don't know that we're gonna save the world of bees. The wonderful thing about science is that it is a collaborative effort, so there's not too much pressure on any one researcher. What I'm hoping to do now is to take my interest and my passion for research on honeybees and honeybee associates, and to use that to create something that other researchers can build off of. There's another parasite that is poised to do something very similar. There's the tropolelapse mite in Southeast Asia, and it's kind of concerning that it's decided that it doesn't just want to hang out in Southeast Asia. It wants to see the world. And so it's been spreading throughout different countries in about the same pattern that Varroa destructor started spreading before we saw it here in the US. Why is all of that important? Well, when Varroa first got here, there was very, very, very little research actually written about these creatures in English. And as a result, we had to spend a good deal of our time kind of basing our projects and our research and our understanding of this creature on work that we really couldn't read and on experiments that, for that reason, we couldn't reproduce. And so we thought that these creatures were feeding on the bee's blood because of a study written in the former Soviet Union. Some of the details of the ways that the experiments were conducted left us with a conclusion that wasn't actually accurate. The same thing could happen with tropolelapse because now a lot of these studies are being written up in Chinese, And as a result, we may not be able to easily verify that these studies are proving the things that we think that they're proving.
So how people can help you to reach those goals, my friend?
Oh.
How people can help you to go to Thailand and, you know, find those answers?
That is such a leading question, Umberto. It's
go
like
for
you
it.
Know that I already have a GoFundMe page for which I'm raising funds to go to Thailand. It's crazy that you would ask something like that.
Unbelievable. It's such a coincidence.
I know. Remarkable.
It's such a coincidence. And by the way, I'm going to leave a link in the description below so you can easily access. And if you're generous enough, you can help this young scientist to find more good stuff.
This guy.
How about that?
This guy is perfect. Love him. See, this is why we watch this channel, right?
Yep.
I
bring the behind the scenes.
Behind the scenes and inside the hive.
Inside the hive.
As he has already alluded to, I've been raising money for a project to go to Thailand and other places in Southeast Asia and to work with tropolelapse mites on their native hosts, on the European honeybees that are currently there, and to look at the different aspects of this organism's biology. There have been really, really, really concerning... there's been very concerning information that's come out recently about the fact that tropolelapse mites have been found on other species of bees in Thailand. So they found them on a number of different honeybee species, but they've even found them on carpenter bees in Thailand. And our worry is that if they arrived in the US, they'd be as destructive, actually much more destructive than Varroa destructor. But Varroa only impacts honeybees. These guys could actually go after our native bees, like our carpenter bees and our bumblebees, and wouldn't that be a mess? So I'm raising money to learn as much as I can about these creatures before they're introduced, if they are ever introduced. I want to know what they're feeding on. I want to know what chemicals can control them. I want to know if we can rear them in the lab so that we can better observe their behaviors and test different chemical constructs on their biology. And I'm going to try my best to get as many of these questions as possible answered in just 9 months. It helps that I already know a little bit of Thai. Pumput pasa Thai dai nit nai hap. So,
wow. Wow. Hi everyone, I feel I need to stop here to split this video in two parts. The next video, next week, Sammy and I will discuss future projects, how to kill Varroa with this new information, and much more. Also, I need to say a couple words regarding Sammy's journey. I follow Sammy from the very beginning. I remember us discussing possibilities, plan Bs and Cs, when I was at University of Maryland, when he was starting this project a long, long time ago. For a long time, I wasn't convinced about the idea he was trying to sell. We could see the potential there, but the data he presented to me for many, many times wasn't enough to convince me or others in the field that in real fat bodies were the main source of food resources for Varroa destructor. Sammy did a fantastic job not giving up and was able to build a solid amount of data that make it difficult now to see otherwise. Now, why am I saying this? I'm saying this because this is a great example of how science works. We always need to go where the evidence leads us. It's not a matter of believing. It's not a problem to change opinion based on new information. When new information comes in, there is no problem to change your opinion. I saw some people coming to me saying, "Umberto, you flipped," with a weird connotation behind it. And I have to say, duh, of course I did. The last time I talked to Sammy and he showed me the electron microscopy work combined with other results they showed to me, that was a revelation. I was so happy for many reasons. First, science moved forward and showed me something new that clearly will help us to find solutions against the biggest enemy of honeybees today, the Varroa mite. Second, the hard work of Sammy paid off, and he achieved something very nice for his career. congratulations to everybody involved in this project. I hope to see more good stuff soon. If you like this video, hit the like button below, subscribe to the channel if you didn't already, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching Inside the Hive.tv, the show about bees. Cheers!